Hey guys, it's Andy with the Storytellers. I just want to say thank you guys for being a part of season one. This experiment that we started has been a blast. And the people that have said yes to this show, I keep pinching myself because just to hear their stories, I feel like this whole podcast has just been something I've gotten a lot out of. And so thank you guys for being a part of that. We're going to wrap up season one now. It is in the books. All 15 episodes have been a blast. And so season one is done. But I wanted to say, season two is coming. So stay tuned. This summer, we will be launching season two. We're going to have a couple seasons a year, and season two launches this summer. The guest list is amazing. We've already done several of them. Gary Sinise, Hillary Swank, Dallas Jenkins, Zachary Levi, Sean Astin. It's just like every single episode has deep meaning, and it's exciting to kind of see this thing grow. So stay tuned. Season two coming at you this summer. Until then, keep telling your stories. And we'll see you on the next edition of The Storytellers. I'm Andy Irwin, and this is The Storytellers. My guest on today's show, I'm really excited about these guys. They're longtime friends, and they're four-time Grammy Award-winning music artists. They've done incredible music over the years. And I remember I was invited, I was at a show for another band and they were opening for them. And I didn't know much about the band. I didn't know who they were, but I was told you have to catch these guys' show. And when they came out, it was something so cinematic, so caught me so off guard. It was theatrical, it was immersive, had great percussion. It was just something that I was like, this is a whole nother level. And to watch them grow from this band that nobody knew to being a household name and to break out beyond the faith space into something that is broadly relatable, very mainstream, but continues to stay true to their faith roots. So you know them for their music and songs like God Only Knows, Burn the Ships, and Drummer Boy, so many other hits. It's exciting to have them on the show to talk a little bit about their journey that has now gone from music into film, and they've got a feature film coming up that I'm a part of called Unsung Hero that I'm so excited about. So all that being said, would you please welcome my guest today, Joel and Luke Smallbone for King of Country.
Thank you for having us.
Just
man.
To prove that we're in person.
We're in person. In person and
no
real friends.
Interview.
Yes, real friends. We like each other.
We're trying our hand at Andy Irwin's day job. Day job is musicians.
You're doing it quite well, actually.
Thank you. We've spent the last, Luke? I mean, particularly year plus working on a feature film amongst doing our day job still.
Which is equally impressive. Like the fact that you guys like are able to multitask where you're out on the road doing your day job of being this award-winning band and then you're on the side making a movie. So how has the juggle been for you guys?
I mean, I think that as we have, I mean, we've been doing this over a decade together now in music. And Joel and I didn't get along, growing up very well. And when we started music,
Luke is the younger brother, but he got taller than me. And he's a better sportsman.
He's still in therapy about it. It's fine.
I've seen that.
And he liked to rub it in.
It's okay, Joel. You're pretty too.
Thank you. I feel validated.
And so I think when we first started, there was a degree of, and we've talked about this a lot. I mean, there was a degree of learning how to work together that was needed and very, very important. And for the first 5 years of us working together, we had zero success. Which I think struggle produces something in people.
You went through a couple of names. It was like Joel and Luke.
Yeah,
and
then it's like Osterville.
Osterville.
The Deep.
The Deep.
Because we were
Joel really was people. Was into another name called Actor and Ash.
Yeah. He was going to be Ash. Yeah.
So we went through a time of really learning how to work together. Mm-hmm. And I think that in some cases, when you ask about, hey, how's it been managing the two? It's taken all of that time. You probably were thinking, where's Luke going with this?
No, but I like it.
It's taken all of this time to get to a point where we can divvy up responsibilities.
It's easy to say that and to kind of give it lip service. But there's something I've kind of, you've been a fly on the wall. I've known you guys for about 10 years.
You don't know anything about being in a brother.
No, not at all. Not at all. I'm here at a therapy session. Tell me how it works.
We're going to talk to you about
exactly.
That next.
I've got a lot more to learn from you guys.
So, Andy Irwin,
let's
talk
about it. Speaking of that, though, like I was actually kind of envious because I was watching you guys. You know, I'd seen iterations throughout the years of you guys kind of learning on the fly. I mean, because you guys were pushed into a duo kind of group together because you wanted to be a basketball star, Luke, and Joel, you know, you wanted to be a lead singer solo act. So there was this kind of underlying tension of who's leading this thing for a little while of how does this fit? And I don't know exactly what happened transition-wise, but I remember it was like K-Love Fan Awards maybe a year or two ago. And I watched you guys on stage. I think you, Luke, you had just come back from vocal surgery and Joel had been having to go solo for a little while. And you came back and I saw the two of you guys on stage and there was an ease to your relationship on stage where what I watched with you, Joel, is rather than waiting for Luke to finish and jump in and say something, you sat back and relaxed in it of letting Luke have the moment. And then there was moments, Luke, where you just pushed Joel to the front and like, I don't have anything to add. There was just an ease between the two of you guys. That seemed to be hard fought getting to that place. What was kind of the catalyst for kind of getting to a place where you saw the value in the other and you were able to kind of later in your career choose each other?
Hard fought is the right phrase because that is actually the phrase that came to mind for me. Hmm. Look, it's a marriage, right? It's a creative marriage. And I think all of the building blocks that go into an actual marriage. Mariah and I just celebrated 10 years. Luke and Courtney are at 12.
Congrats.
13 awesome. This year. So when you look at actual marriage, the struggle, mm-hmm. the perseverance, the conflict resolution.
Right.
Also knowing your roles, like what are you actually good at? I think there's a lot of times where we think we're good at something and everyone's going, yeah, he's not very good at that. But like, and so there's a lack of awareness, of self-awareness. Which I will say, when we started out, there was a radical lack of self-awareness on my part in how I related to Luke because I had spent years in my teenagehood writing and recording on my own, and he had not. Actually, the first song he ever wrote was a song we wrote. And so actually, it was reset. It was like the order of business was the sort of pecking order started out in the right spot. But then my challenge probably from that day to Fan Awards at the Grand Ole Opry 2-3 years ago was how to not keep him in his corner.
Yeah.
You know, just like, no, you do that. That's your function. Yeah. I'm the guy.
Right.
And that's what I think you subtly picked up with those. Cause I'm by way of confession. Yeah. There, if you go back and watch acceptance speeches or on stage, yeah, I'm back there kind of going, all right,
wrap it up.
Finish up.
Wrap it up.
Okay. Let me say my bit.
I've got a British monologue.
Here. British Australian confused accent. Let me go. And so the struggle, staying in it, and then the struggle of us both working through, Luke faced illness at a point, which was very revealing for me. The vocal surgery was very revealing. I faced more of the quiet struggles of ego and wanting to control and wanting to be my own man and thinking that I have the best idea in the room. All those, the more frightening versions, like the hidden motivations.
Well, and I would say this, differing opinion is normal and healthy.
Right.
Right.
There's the element of friction is necessary. Right,
but how you get to solutions.
Right.
Is what is probably the definition of a healthy work relationship and a healthy relationship as a whole. And I think for Joel and I, there were probably things that we disagreed on in the film, but there's processes to getting to a conclusion or sometimes Joel uses the word a compromise that is just kind of normal in how we do things. So it never gets to a red zone. You know, it never gets to an argument of like, you know, well, how dare you because of X, Y, Z. Right. And look, Joel and I have had the arguments by the hundreds at this point.
Yeah.
And at this point, we probably both know each other well enough to know that, hey, Luke's doing this because maybe his pride was hurt. Or Luke's saying this because he genuinely believes this is better. And could I be wrong? Early on, you know, I think when you're a young man particularly, you just don't ever think you're wrong.
Right.
And the problem is you have to, I think, in partnerships, recognize, wait a second, I'm fighting for this and I should fight for this. But there's a chance that I'm wrong.
I remember we met at a, it was at a Casting Crowns concert, and you guys were the opening act.
Yeah.
And so I was there screening one of our early films for the band for Casting Crowns. I had heard about you guys, but I wasn't really familiar with your music. And your dad grabbed me by the collar and pulled me into your dressing room and said, you got to meet my boys. They're a great musical act, and Joel's going to be an actor. And then he said, you have to sit on the band devotions. And so I don't even know who these people
are. You said, yes, sir.
I was scared. I was like, yeah, whatever. This really intense old man is pulling me in. Okay, good. And then he's like, you have to sit on the front row and watch my boys play. So I sat there, and you guys came out, and I had never, in the Christian space in particular, I had never heard anything like it. The only thing I knew how to equate it to was the last Coldplay concert I'd been to. It was very unique. So you talk about the different iterations of the band that you've tried different things on to see what fit. Like during those years, how did you guys discover your identity and be like, this is what we're going to do? It's going to be this band with this sensibilities, this theatricality, this sound. Where did you guys find your identity?
I think a lot of people probably look at, you start with, well, what can I do? What are my abilities?
Yeah.
And you work backwards from like, well, what can I do? And what can I do really well? I think in some cases, Joel and I looked at the things that we actually can't do.
Hmm.
There was a lot of restrictions. Joel and I aren't necessarily, musicians in the sense of we can go and just, play piano like crazy or shred on a guitar. Like we can play things, but, I grew up playing drums. And I love to play drums, still love to play drums, but most anybody that plays drums is probably better than me.
Yeah.
But I love drums. And so when it came to, early on trying to find an identity of sound, it was, if everybody else was doing it one way, I heard a radio person say something to me once that I found very fascinating, because I think this applies to all art. He said, I said, what's it like introducing, it was on our first radio tour. He said, what's it like introducing a new artist to people? And he goes, well, it's twofold. It's very exciting because they don't have a track record of any failure.
Yep.
So they can't necessarily say, I'm not going to do this. But the problem is you have no track record of success. And so you have to balance the idea. And then he basically said this, but if you're a new artist and you sound like somebody else, and this is music speaking, but I think it's applicable to movies as well. If it looks and sounds like something else, why wouldn't they just play the more successful version of you as an artist?
Wow.
So you have to be different. You have to be unique. So I think for us, it was always thinking through that. And at that time, nobody was really beating the living tar out of drums. And it's like, I love drums. I can beat the living tar out of drums. And so you get up on stage and you evoke an emotion with your passion, with your excitement. And I think that those were kind of the loose rules that we were trying to play by early on.
I think that makes sense, because with your love of percussion and Joel's love of theatricality, it's Braveheart with a great drum beat.
Yeah,
Joel, for you guys, like, what was the was there a moment, like, for us, it was the movie Woodlawn that you guys walked through with us on that whole thing. Up to that point, I was just trying on different hats. I was like, maybe this will work. Maybe this will work. And so you see those early films, and they're good. They're okay. But they're not authentically us. And when we found Woodlawn, we found the power of a true story, kind of an underdog redemption story. And then we're like, let's do that over and over again. That's our brand. And so that was the moment that the switch flipped for us. So for you guys, with the costumes, the outfits, the percussion, the passion, the sound, the audience, what was the moment that it clicked of, we know who we are?
It was a very specific moment, actually. It was built on, like Luke said, this concept that there's beauty in confinement.
Right.
And we looked at the fact that we weren't incredibly proficient musicians, but we could sing, or that Luke could play rhythm quite well, as not as limitations, but as something we should lean into. It was, funnily enough, I think, our first Christmas tour. And to set the record straight, we had no right doing a Christmas tour. It was the year we'd released our first album, it was 2012. And we were just excited that we could actually put people in a room. And so we kind of said, well, let's...
There weren't many people. There were people.
Like, well, let's just do this. Let's do a Christmas tour. We can pull a bunch of Christmas songs together. And so we crammed ourselves into the Franklin factory for 2 days.
Wow.
And again, we have no Christmas album, no Christmas singles. And we said, let's just pick some of our favorite Christmas songs.
Wow.
It was very run and gun. And come up with our own renditions of them. With the whole band. And so some of them out of that were, you know, Angels We've Heard on High, Emmanuel, and namely The Little Drummer Boy.
Drummer Boy.
And wow. Basically the version you hear today is the version we came up with at that old factory in 2012.
That gave me chills.
And we discovered something in that, the rhythm of that. I mean, we felt we were being very on the nose because it was like, this is a song about a boy playing drums. And we just put a load of drums on it, you know. But nonetheless, we played it. We opened the night with it at these Christmas shows. And it was just something about the way the drums built and the feeling of the song that. And then we sort of like, well, what if we were kind of like, we were sort of, it's Christmas, so we should get dressed up. But we don't just want to be like a ska band in like suits.
Right.
So let's be a little bit, it's for King and Country. It's British. It's a mantra. It's old, let's lean in a little bit more there. So we did that Christmas. And then 2013, so almost 10 years ago, we were invited by Jay Leno before he finished his tenure at The Tonight Show to play The Tonight Show. And we played The Proof of Your Love. We had this big rhythm section at the end with orchestra cymbals and the drums and the outfits.
Yep.
And that was a very, there was a before and after. January 10th, 2013, on The Tonight Show with Jay Leno. It was, we had kind of fumbled along up until that point live. Mm-hmm. And then that night was like, I think this is what we should do. Huh. And we built on it really from that day to this and just sort of elaborated.
That's amazing. I mean, we've known each other for 10 years and I've really never made the connection where that moment was.
Yeah. You kind of all thank Drummer Boy in some ways.
Drummer Boy, it all goes back to Drummer Boy. And it will continue to go to Drummer Boy eventually. We've got more to come on that subject. You have that moment as an artist where you kind of sit back and you're like, holy cow, it worked. It's working. And then there comes a moment where all of a sudden now you have influence. And then it's kind of, you have to go beyond like what works to like, what do we have to say? Like, what are we about? What do we want to stand for?
I've often said this and Joe may, you know, laugh or say, I'm not sure that's right. But I've often thought that I'm not a good enough and maybe we're not good enough songwriters.
I'm not sure that's right.
We're not good enough songwriters to write about things that don't move us, that don't wreck us, that don't put a tear in our eye, that don't, or in some cases, don't anger you, that don't evoke an emotion. Because those are the things that, you know, I'll tell you this story. The first song I ever wrote that I was proud of was a song called Crave, and it was on the first album.
Yeah, it was
named after the album. And I remember writing the song, and I remember thinking to myself, as I put the CD, remember those, in the car.
Little summer
and, yeah, in the car. And I played the demo on the way home. And I just kept looping it over and over again. And I remember thinking to myself, if no one ever hears this song means something to me.
Wow.
And what happened was, is I realized in the coming months that there's millions and millions of people going through almost the same things.
Exactly. Wow. It's like the audience can tell when you're asking them to go on a journey that you're not willing to go on yourself.
Yeah.
So there's an authenticity to it.
There's a great adage that I think surmises what Luke's saying, and I think surmises what you and John discovered on Woodlawn, Andy, and that is pay attention to where your tears fall. And I would even add to that, pay attention to what moves other people to where their tears fall. Tears of joy, tears of hurt, tears of sadness, because that's the point of the poet, right, is to pay attention to the emotional journey that a human is on and speak to it in song.
And the fascinating thing as well is the audience, when they finally kind of take ownership of it, you know, there's something about when you, you know, when you hear a U2 song on an album, but then you see a U2 song in concert.
Yeah.
It's a completely different communal experience where the audience decides what's a lasting song.
Yeah.
And I've been surprised because, you know, with your albums, because we're friends, I get, you know, early glimpses of some of the music you're doing. And there's songs where I'll be like, that's the song because it means something to me. But then the song that takes off is the one I didn't expect. So like for me, it was like God Only Knows. Because there was a couple other songs on that album that personally meant more to me.
No one cared about that
song. Yeah, and God Only Knows, it was a good song, but it went over my head.
Huh.
But then when it released, to watch the audience embrace like that one, and I was like, oh my gosh. And then I would see it in concert, and I would see the people, how they would surge and respond to that. Is that shocking or surprising to you guys as artists to kind of see that happen?
Well, God Only Knows is a funny one. It was a great gift, but to be punny, the reason it really worked is because we just say God Only Knows like 90 times in a song.
And then you had like Dolly Parton help you say that again.
And then we wanted to give Dolly Parton, you know, she's an upcoming artist. We
yeah, give her a break.
She's been at it
You're
for
so
a long
kind
time.
To her.
We wanted to give her a break.
Yeah.
No, that's a whole other story, but one of the great compliments of our career is Dolly partnering on that. I feel like what you're speaking to is there's this transfer that happens.
Yeah.
That you write these songs and they're very much our story or your story, and then you present them to people, and then some of them become their story, and some of them stay and boomerang back to you, and they're yours. But those stories that you can transfer and you sort of give away, and there's these very clear moments. I don't know if you have it in filmmaking, but there's a very clear moment where you go. And Bono speaks to this in his book, Surrender, where you go, all right, this was my moment. This was my song. Mm. And then there's this poignant moment that happens live and you go, it's theirs now.
Wow.
Like you've given it over to them.
And, that's amazing.
And then it becomes this real beautiful act of service when you sing it, is you're doing it for them. That's what it's all driving towards. The songs on the radio, the songs on streaming platforms, the music videos, it's all driving towards, let's have this experience together in the room where this is the one time in human history that this will ever happen, that this group of people will be together, that we will get to articulate these songs that these digital platforms have pushed into your iPhone or onto the radio, and then we have this moment. It's quite, if you're able to just sit in it. And obviously there are points where we have to show up and just do our day job, but there are just moments that will just take your breath away because you don't have those frontiers very much anymore. It's everything's so digital.
Well, I think that's the beauty. I think that's the direct correlation between, you know, being a musician that does concerts with film is it should in its purest form always kind of culminate in like a communal in-person experience where they're interacting as a group with it, whether it's in a movie theater or you know, an arena. It's that same kind of shared experience. And as you guys began to delve into other creative outlets for it, I remember starting to see your music videos. And there's a cinematic quality you began to bring into the brand. And, you know, my brother and I had a three-year run where we were kind of the it guys as far as music video directors in the Christian space, and did many videos for Skillet and, you know, and some stuff for Switchfoot and different things like that. But we had prided ourselves on our videos. And then I saw the videos that you guys were doing with your brother Ben, and I saw the first one and I was like, okay, we just got lapped. I think it was the video for Shoulders that maybe that was the one that really was like, okay, these guys are going somewhere. And then you took it to places like when you did the Burn the Ships videos and different things like that, where it's like, oh, it's a mini movie. And you continue to up the game. As you brought the visuals into it, like how was that process for you guys?
Well, so we grew up making movies and, you know, things at home on your little...
Luke was always that we would do short films, like bad versions of Indiana Jones spinoffs with
well, I think we need that for research purposes.
Well, you do. And Luke could never remember his lines, which he somewhat struggles with on stage.
I still do. Yeah, I still that's part of the reason why you'll never find me acting.
Yeah.
And, because I can't remember the lines.
I love that.
I think he's got a taller ceiling than he thinks he does. But nonetheless, he was always the one that we would get killed off in the short films. Because it would be like,
making a short film is
awesome. Just kill him.
Luke, this is where you die.
Because back then, it would be like, hey, so this is Indiana Jones, this guy. So you're going to be the little, because remember the one movie where they have the other guy.
Yeah. Short round.
I was meant to be.
Tall round.
That's right. And so you would come up with the lines like there. So like, Luke, you're going to say, Indy, why can't I do whatever? And it would progress like this. Like, Luke, you, that line now, and, you know, we would shoot it probably twice.
Uh-huh.
And then it was like, okay, this is not working. We're going to kill you. I mean, it would progress at that level. So
that is awesome.
So I was always, so then I started being the guy that pressed record, honestly, a lot. I was always behind the camera.
I love it.
And also, but anyway, we had dreams of, you know, it's always fascinating to me what comes early on. I'm not going to say that we had dreams of hoping to make music videos at different levels, but I will say that we had hopes of being able to get budgets to make things that we thought were just preposterous.
Right.
And in some cases, the music videos became like, man, well, we've got this music and the label wants us to make something. Well, let's go outrageous. Like, why wouldn't we make it absolutely amazing? We used to dream of opportunities like this as kids. And in some cases, there's dreams that you dream subconsciously that you don't ever think will eventuate. And I think for both Joel and I, we got to a point with Ben, and it's kind of like, guys, they're going to give us X amount of dollars to go do this. Well, why don't we try? I mean, can we blow up a ship? You know, can we fly? What can we do? And in some cases, I think we realized that the hope would be to eventually make movies.
Hmm.
And you have to put in your hours. You have to get good at telling a story. You have to get good at the craft of the shots and in some cases, the patience and all these different things to be able to make something. And in some cases, I think the music videos were that for us. That was our training ground.
And it was very, and you know this, and you do this really well, Andy, in filmmaking, it was very holistic, which we love. Because when you go from music to movies, because people are like, well, how did you like, you co-wrote it and Luke produced it. It was Luke's idea to do Unsung Hero. And how did you guys, and now you're going to promote it. It's like, this just makes sense to do. We come up with a story, you know, or the true story in this case. We develop it with people. We work in our roles to perform it and present it. We market it. And it feels very native. And I think it's because of those short films going into music, going into music videos, and then this little dabbling in movies.
So with the movies, you know, as you transitioned in the movies, you did Priceless, which was a brilliant, important movie about human trafficking. And I know the pain and the joy of doing your first film. That's where you learn the most about how to find your audience. There's also the hopes and dreams, and then the reality. And so, all the stuff that you had done kind of led to this moment with Unsung Hero. And I remember I was at the factory with you, Joel.
Factory is this little through line here, guys. If you come to Nashville,
it is the place where things happen.
The factory at Franklin. Look it up. They're doing some good stuff.
And it's getting better and better. We walked through the factory, which is this old industrial factory that they've turned into kind of like a shopping venue, artistic kind of place. And so we're walking through there and you said, I've got this idea for my family story that Luke and I have been working on. And you... allowed me to read the script. And then we walked through the factory and kind of talked through that. Like, where did the idea and the genesis of, hey, let's do our family story. That's what we're going to do next. Because you had a lot of options on the table, a lot of really good options. But you centered on, this was the dark horse that kind of won out. Who was the advocate for it?
Well, obviously there's to any idea that gets made,
the short always answer
more,
is
well, there's always more advocates than just one.
Yeah, right.
But there's someone that at least raises their hand. And a little bit of a backstory for me, when we do our shows, we have a moment where I tell my family story.
Right.
And the impact and response to that story, because I'm the one telling the story, I have seen it shift rooms. Like, I've seen it kind of people go, that is an outrageous story. And then you go, I mean, that's true. And it was, you know, our parents' yep. story. I saw that for like 10 years. Mm. And I went to Joel and then a producer in LA who had said, hey, I want to make another, one of the producers on Priceless, I want to make another film with you guys. So I just called him up one day and said, hey, man, I just think we need to put this story into development and see. I think we could make it fairly cost efficiently. We've got
producer, by the way.
That's right,
producer. Uh-huh.
We've got big.
Let's get all the money possible.
We've got big plans, but I didn't see a way for the other movies that we've got in our heads. I just didn't see how you were going to go to Hollywood or in town here and go, yeah, I'm going to give you $15 million. Yeah. When you haven't made really a successful film, and so. I felt like there was something particularly about telling a family story that isn't pretty, that there's a lot of struggle. I think people can relate to that because I don't know a family that's not, dysfunctional.
It was the inception.
And to Joel's credit, Joel was not fully on board with this.
I was literally, you're telling me, I don't even like this idea. Like, you're telling me we have producers flying out. What are we doing here again?
That's awesome. That's awesome. And then you had to appeal to the actor and be like, but Joel, you're pretty. He's like, okay.
He's like, but Joel, you can play dad. I'm like, I'm in.
I'm totally in. The thing that was interesting about it is I think sometimes you find what ideas are valuable and what aren't when you hit adversity. Right. And there's times as a filmmaker where somebody has come up and give me kind of the honest facts and they punch me in the mouth and my knees buckle and I'm be like, not that film. We sat down that day at the Franklin. I had read the script.
Yeah.
And he said, I just want the honest truth. And graciously, softly, I punched you in the mouth.
Right.
And I just said,
and I recorded the whole thing. I still have it.
But and it made everybody hate me in one day. But,
sorry,
but
I passed it on to the wrong people.
It got disseminated to the whole creative team. But I just said, Joel, this is a great idea, but it's a lot about the what, and I don't understand the why yet. Like, why do I care for this family?
I remember you saying it,
and said a lot of things after that. But that was the gist of it. And I was really watching to see how you would respond, because if your knees buckled, then the idea wasn't worth fighting for. But I watched you kind of get in it with, all your passion and said, we're going to fight for this story.
Yeah.
You took Richard Ramsey, your co-writer, co-director, out on the road. And like, poor, I think you kidnapped him. And like,
I did. He has five kids too.
Yeah, put him on a tour bus.
I went to his house.
You'll see him in 3 weeks.
In the middle of the night. It's like, I put him in a sack.
And you do have this vortex ability to convince people to do things and think it's their idea.
Well, I need to throw a shout out to Joshua Walsh on that one, because he really got it.
Josh was the other ingredient, because Josh produced
it.
Look,
what's interesting about, because so you got the first moment in the middle of the pandemic where we started developing, and then Richard on his own, really, with a little bit of, or a lot of sort of guidance and misguidance from a host of people.
A lot of voices, a lot of cooks in the kitchen.
Took kind of two steps forward and one step back for like 2 years.
Yep.
Just tried this, tried that. And really, by the end, was pulling his hair out, because he was just getting, there was a load of voices and a load of different capable people trying to make four different movies. Like, one guy wanted it to be sort of an adventure kids movie. One person wanted it to be sort of a musical. One person wanted it to be a drama. Like, so he just got to a point in 2022, which is when we met at the Franklin Factory. Check it out. and you read his script, which was him as a creative desperately trying to take all of the spirit of all the notes and cram them into one thing. And that's when you end up with a what instead of a why.
Right.
Because it's there, but you don't know what the through line is. And you gave such great notes. And I do want to give credit to you for kindly throwing the punches. And also to any creatives that are listening, if you take one thing away as a creative from this, you must, and I say this with as much emphasis as I can, take criticism and create a safe place for fellow trusted, in all capitals, trusted creatives to speak into your art. You have to develop a Witten, a team, an arsenal of collaborators who you respect that can speak into it. And I have to recognize, starting with you, I mentioned John Gunn, your brother, Reddit. There's a host of people. Luke spoke into it. Josh Wall spoke. My wife spoke into it. Candace spoke into it. There was a load of people that came around that script.
Yep.
And I know I'm missing some, so just forgive me. But that spoke into the script, that felt safe to speak into it. And the film is what it is because of that.
Yeah.
You know, Richard and my names might be on the screenwriter's list, but man, it was and all of us.
I think the thing that happened brilliantly, and it happened from Josh Walsh that produced the movie with you, Luke. Josh Walsh worked for me since he was 19, branched out to producing on his own, produced Jesus Revolution with my brother and Kevin Downs and myself. And then this was his first time being the lead producer. And so he came in very precisely and took the notes that I had given creatively and came up with a really great producing solution. And he's like, you need the right voices informing it, but the right people need to be empowered to execute it. And it just needs to be a very precise voice, which funneled down to you and Richie.
Yeah.
And so you went out on the road. 3 weeks later, you come back with a script, kind of coming down from the mountain of the Ten Commandments. And we read that script. It was like, Josh and I talked, and we're like, oh, we've got a movie. It's really good.
We took the conference, the creative conference room approach, which will never make great art. It might make a great bit for like breaking the story.
Right.
Right. What are the key points? But we took the conference room creative approach and we shrunk it all the way back to like, it was Richie and me, and got all of the other voices. We had your input, but got all the other voices literally and figuratively out of the room. And I think it was, for to be precise, it was 10 days. We did a page one rewrite.
Man.
We were in the middle of doing shows. So I would literally, forgive me to the audiences that were at these shows, but I would literally like wake up. We would work for 6 or 8 hours on the script. I would like step on the stage or into a meet and greet, do the show. And then we would have another 3 or 4 hour session that later that night. And we just went through the whole thing. And that was, I think, when it went from a what
to a really good why. Really good why. And so for Luke, for you guys, you step in to make the movie. And I remember when I was meeting with you and Walsh, and I had decided, hey, I'll come on as an executive producer and lend my name to this thing. You guys had a very aggressive timeline that you wanted to shoot it at. Like, you know, you picked planted a flag on the hill. It's like, we're going to take that mountain at this time. And I looked at it. I was like, I think you guys are crazy. I don't know any way that you can stick the landing. That you've got your brother who's not only starring in it, but he's also co-directing it. And you're going to have to shoot it on this budget at this deadline. It reminded me of that moment in the movie Interstellar, where Matthew McConaughey is looking at the spinning space station, and he has to match the same spin. And Anne Hathaway turns to him and is like, "That's impossible." And he's like, "No, that's necessary.
Necessary. I literally watched it 5 days ago.
So
again.
Good.
Gosh.
So good. It's necessary." So you guys, you and Walsh and the team, kind of put this battle plan together that was very aggressive, and like really stuck the landing. It was like the great atmosphere on set, and everything about it was the way filmmaking at its purest should be. Like, talk to me about that experience of how to stick the landing.
Well, I think I'd love to be like, yeah, here's a, you know, a PowerPoint of how we actually, in some cases you're foolish enough to try.
Yeah.
And I think that probably in
and
music,
we backed ourselves far enough into a corner.
We didn't have a choice, because when you start to pull apart scheduling, is probably the thing that's helpful about music, and the thing that is a little bit dangerous is like that Christmas tour was coming, and we had those dates there, and that was what was going to be, and you can't move it. We also the next year had a spring tour, so the only gap that we could really end up shooting was when we were shooting.
And
so
by the way, postponed a Canadian tour, and we'd canceled our fall tour. Or not, we'd never gone on sale, but we'd had it routed. We'd canceled our fall tour. On a year that we released What Are We Waiting For as a record, 2022,
man, so risky.
To make the film.
So I think that in some cases, we had relentless positivity. We had relentless joy. And if you go talk to a lot of the people that worked on that set, it doesn't mean there wasn't hard moments, but a lot of times they will say that set had an unbelievable amount of joy.
I agree. I felt it. I felt it. You can feel when a film set feels like that.
And there were miracles too. And you were one of them, coming on when you did and kindly you know, Walsh coming on, and Walsh having 10 years under your leadership to be able to know how to, Monarch had to step away, and so we had to raise $6 million in 3 weeks, and
right.
how to navigate that. And Daisy Betts, who plays our mum, came, she's in Australia, mother of four. We found it 10 days, you remember well, but 10 days before the film began. There were all of these things.
That call her out of retirement for that. Like she'd been, she'd been out for a few years. Yeah. And
these miraculous sort of inexplicable things. And it does just go to show when you do, I think this is what prophecy and this is what vision casting is, when you are aligned with God and the will of God. And God is very much about love and marriage and family and faith and banding together and setting aside your ego and setting aside your selfishness. Like these are all things that God is very much for. And this is are all the things that the film is really trying to highlight. When you come at it from that approach, I think there's a very tangible cosmic thing that God kind of goes, yeah, right. You've made your plans. I'm going to order your steps now. And we felt that, man.
I remember when we had a COVID situation and Walsh was flipping out. I mean, he was losing his mind.
As only he could do.
And he was like, well, they got to shut us down. And I remember thinking after like weeks later, and he was like, look at what we were. I remember going to him. I was like, I expected to keep filming.
Yeah. Huh. Yeah. And I'm not saying it's about us. In hindsight, I'm terrified how not terrified we were. Looking back, I was like, well, you called it. Yeah. Like, you guys are right on the edge here. And we were like, it's going to be fine.
And there were other people losing their mushrooms.
And for the record, we were working incredibly hard too.
Yeah. No.
You know.
Well, and I think a lot of that transitioned and transferred onto the screen. Like that struggle and that idea that we don't have any option but to unite arms and survive. And we're going to fight together. And that idea that we're going to win as a team. And for you playing your father, who was also very much backed into a corner during this season of your family's life, for the people that don't know the story of Unsung Hero is your family immigrating from Australia, coming here to the United States, your dad chasing a job after one of his biggest failures back home and thinking that he's going to start a new career here in the States, lost that job right away, and your family had to unite to figure out how to survive. And I think the through line of the film became, you know, what your dad experienced in that was for all this time, he thought his family was in the way, but he found out his family was the way. And so did you feel like a lot of what you went through as a team, as a family making this movie, your family making cameos in this movie, do you feel like a lot of that transition and inform your performance?
Yeah, I mean, there's part of it. I remember there was this one day, and this is going to sound like a humble brag, and it is.
And you can do that well. You're good at that. Do it with a British accent, you're good.
That Mel Gibson. Yeah. Mel Gibson came by the set, and I. This is a man who you referenced, Braveheart.
Yep, master storyteller.
Master storyteller, and one of the great inspirations for me in filmmaking. Yep. And frankly,
all of us.
The fact that he was able to direct and be behind the camera and hop in front of the camera on mm-hmm. such an epic scale with
right.
Braveheart. I got to shake his hand and tell him personally that part of the reason I'm doing this is because you were outrageous enough to kind of go before us and show us that it can be done. Mm. So there was a part of it, and he said himself, he said, what did he say back? He said, it's not perspiration, it's preparation. It's all, you know, something to that effect. And, I think, and he also said, he's like, man, I didn't have time to think.
Wow. Yeah. There is something to be said for that.
As an actor. Like I was so beside myself the whole time. I was like, we just get the job done. Mm. And I think there was two things that really helped me as a reasonably novice actor still. One is it's playing my dad. Like I've studied the subject for 30 odd years now. I know the man.
Right.
And I know, and I've worked with him for most of my life, and right. I know all the facets, and I know even writing him and his quirks and all the rest of it. And it was really fun to not imitate him, but to try and find his essence, number one.
And you did it well.
Thank you. Number two was, man, I was such a workman. It was like, I didn't have time to think. I'd get in front of the screen and be like, well, this is what the thing needs to be. So let's do it. And there was another little secret gem in there too. And that was Luke Mestrin's. We had these four kids. Two under 18, two of which are playing Luke and me, which is very sort of multiverse of us. But I was able to coach them in the scene in real time
wow.
as a director, as an actor,
as their father.
Wow.
And multiple one of them is actually me. I mean, it gets really twisted. But I was able to sort of direct them in the scene. Yeah. And that was something I'd never thought about in advance, but it was such a gift to be able to go, I know what I want them to feel, and to be able to push and pull on them in real time to get the thing I needed out of them in the scene. So there was all these little gifts that I think were, in the end, blessings as a performer to be able to, you know, execute the role.
So with, you know, the movie ultimately highlights the unsung hero of your family is your mother.
Right.
And Daisy Betts plays this role to a T. Like, she absolutely is the anchor for the entire film. And I remember, I was there on set for the last day, and we're filming this beautiful burn the ships moment that happens that I won't give away, but it's a gorgeous
and yes, mother to moment. Those that are familiar, it's a nod.
It is. There's a lot of little nods that. So for your fans, it definitely they'll find those, you know, really hidden gems that connect to the music they love. But with this burn the ships moment where she gives this beautiful speech, I remember being on set just having chills, watching the sun going down. And I had given you guys a 20% chance of sticking the landing. Because I was like,
thanks for the confidence.
Yeah, no, because I just,
man, you know what? You are a great friend.
Thank you. So, because I knew what was up against you.
Yeah,
like, I had done enough films to know, like, what they're doing is impossible.
Well, and the truth is, just for a little bit of a peek behind the curtain, there were no extra days.
No, there were. Like, no.
There was zero. You had which I would never do again.
You had no option but to stick the landing. Yeah. But I gave you a 20% chance of this going from great film to train wreck.
Yeah.
And I was like, and we got to the end, and the sun's going down, and I had a tear in my eye, and I'm looking at you directing the scene, because you got to be full director in that moment. You weren't acting in that scene. And I watched you producing from behind the monitor, and I watched Walsh, and I got a tear in my eye, and I'm like, holy cow, they just did it. Like, they just stuck the landing on a really good movie. Mm. There's that moment where you transfer the song from being yours to the audience, and that transition's happening now. Mm. What was it like to get to the end of that journey and to realize it worked? It's working. Like, the movie is what we hoped it would be.
Well, I mean, obviously the film hasn't come out yet, and you don't still know with all those metrics if it's going to be successful or not. Obviously, we hope it will. And all the metrics are saying that the story works. And at the end of the day, I think sometimes people get ahead of themselves in art. And they basically start to say that the art is only worthwhile if it performs at X amount of money or does whatever. I think to creatives, you have to work backwards from, does the story have to be told?
Yeah.
Success or failure?
Well said.
And I think that this story has to be told. And I think that when you look at where the world finds itself with where families are, my heart breaks for the lack of confidence that the world has in the power of family.
Right.
My hope is this is not going to solve all problems, right? But I hope it contributes to just people feeling encouraged, built up, that they can be a better father, that they can be a better mother, that they can be a better sibling. That's where this movie has power. And I think that what I came back from, and when I watched it and I got to, you know, soak it in and have some chats with Joel, is just like, hey, man, we've done what we've set out to do. The team of people now, we all have to bound together, and we hope, and man, that God blesses it. It does fantastic. Yeah. But even if it doesn't, what a win.
Yeah.
What a win. And what a wonderful thing to be on the journey, obviously, as brothers, but as friends, and the group of people that have done it together. This is not one person's story. Yes, it might be our parents, you know, driving the force of the narrative of it. But man, I look at it and I'm satisfied. Mm. But if it does $100 million or it does 10, I'm satisfied.
And I think the exciting thing, just for me to be able to brag on you guys, like you said, the movie comes out in April.
April 26th, which we didn't know when Lionsgate said it, but it's actually Mom and Dad's 49th wedding anniversary.
Oh my gosh. Did you not know that? Mine just got blown.
Yeah.
We'd set the date, and then I'm talking to Mom on the phone. We're talking to Mom, and I'm like, yeah, so it's going to be April 26th. She's like, oh, did you know that's our 49th wedding anniversary? And I was like, yeah, Mom. Yeah,
absolutely.
It's completely exactly new.
Like, storyteller.
That's why we planned it.
But it comes out in April. And I've never been more proud of a film I've been a part of. And I had such a smaller role to play in it. It was really about setting you guys up to win and let you do what you've been, you know, there's that beautiful moment as a storyteller to be able to pass the baton to the, you know, fresh legs in the race. And it was really exciting to see you guys excel in that moment. And my father watched the film and he keeps coming back to me over and over again to the point where it's starting to cause a little bit of a nervous tick for me because he keeps coming back and being like, that unsung hero movie, best thing you've ever made. And I'm like, no offense to the other films that you directed. It's the best thing you ever made. And I'm like, at first I'm like, yeah, Dad, I totally agree. And now I'm like, Dad, you know, I make movies too. But I've never been more proud of a product because I think it's a story, like you said, Luke, that needs to be told regardless. It's not just about the commerce. But I do think that it's one that's going to connect with audiences, and I'm extremely proud. So for me, I think, you know, as we kind of wrap things up, you know, this podcast is dedicated to the storytellers that have gone before us, the storytellers that are coming after us, those stories that have inspired us and changed us. So for you guys, what do you feel like makes a good storyteller, and who are the storytellers that have inspired you guys to do what you're doing as you kind of continue your craft?
Well, first of all, your words are kind. I do want to recognize you might on paper have been an executive producer, but we stand on the shoulders of giants. And this is the beautiful thing about sort of creative legacy, is that you paved a trail, raised up people like Josh Walsh, refined your skills over a couple of decades, and then are seemingly very simply able to guide and offer insight that, if I break down the way it all came about, pivotal. There's no film without Josh Walsh. I don't think there would have been clarity on the script as to what the why was without you. And that's everything. So I mentioned Braveheart and Mel. It's a key component to our journey. Steven Spielberg has continued in a very different way, but has continued just to tell very grounded stories. I've watched The Fablesman recently, and yep, it was a very similar film, and it was about his family, yep, about his story, about his parents, and a very heart film. It gave a lot of credibility and confidence to the fact that we're doing this. Hmm. So there's a long. I mean, musicians are storytellers too. Bono's an incredible storyteller. Yeah. These men that have gone before us and paved the trail.
His Surrender book was fantastic.
Fantastic. Yeah. If you like this form of podcasting and audiobooks, listen to the audiobook of his book Surrender, because yeah, he did a magnificent job. And he's a bit of a thespian himself, and very theatrical.
Yeah.
He does all the voices, yeah, and the whole thing. Those would be a few. I mean, you, like I said before, what you guys have done as brothers, my wife says this often as a Hispanic woman. She says, you know, you can't be what you can't see.
Hmm.
And even that, there's something about from Luke and me and partnering with our brother Ben as well on different projects. It's like, and we partner with Josh and Daniel. There's a slew of small brothers, as you know. But you guys going ahead of us and saying, hey, well, you're building something where it's like, you can do this as brothers. Hmm. It gives you that credibility. I remember when we worked on Priceless and playing it for you, and you kind of going, yeah, you've actually got something really special here. It's like, you can't put a price tag on that stuff. So, yeah. Thanks, those, man, are the stories and the people just on a short list that have been very impacting.
Oh, that's awesome. Luke, you know, as far as just last thoughts, you know, for people that have an ambition to tell their stories, whether it's musically, whether it's, you know, with what they say, whether it's, you know, film, what encouragement would you have to them as far as
their voice? You guys may laugh at this statement, but I'm just going to go with it. I was watching Frozen 2.
There you go.
See? I told you I was a prophet. I knew you'd laugh.
Anytime you tease me up with, you might do this.
Yeah, just go ahead.
Just do it. Yeah.
Low hanging fruit.
And I was watching the movie. And obviously, it's very well done. It's interesting you were talking about people that have really impacted me. Obviously, the Pixar tree of storytelling, absolutely, has been. Because I think you 100%. Can apply that to pretty much every creative endeavor that you're on. I've got four kids, so I watch a lot of these types of movies. And what you realize about absolutely brilliant art is it will bring out an emotion in kids.
Mm.
At the same time as adults, right? And I was watching Frozen 2, and I am going somewhere here, creatives, trust me. And I get to like the, it's almost to the end. And Anna's character starts singing that song in the cave, which she starts singing, do the next right thing.
Yep.
And I remember sitting there and like the rest of the movie just vanished. And I was like, oh my goodness. It's what profound. An absolutely monstrosity of a point that is. And I think creatives get caught up in a lot of distractions of the type of art that they're doing. Am I, you know, well, I got to just get this done. And I don't care how necessarily I'm going to treat people to get that. I just got to get it done. And I got to blah, blah, blah. I would say to creatives, always attempt to do the next right thing. Hmm. I think that if people could take that in their workplace, in their families, and into their, and maybe especially in their creative endeavors, I just think that you put one foot in front of the other, you know, several years go down and you're attempting to do what Hannah said and the next right thing. I think you'll be well on your way in doing incredible and creative things.
For both of you guys, dear friends, it's also really exciting to be, there's something that happens when artists are in proximity that have an equal alignment and an equal ability to execute things, the stories that we can all be, you know, behind and believe in. And instead of there being a heightening of ego, there's a lessening, because it's like, I want to see you guys win more than anything. And so, because the story delivers, because what you have to say is meaningful, and because the way you do it has class. And so when you get in proximity to people that are like that, you just say, let's do more stuff together. So I wanted to have you on the podcast because I think, obviously your body of work as musicians speaks for itself, but I do feel like where your brand is going and what you're developing, film and telling stories like this is more and more in your future. And I'm excited to be applauding that. So, it's a treat to have you on the show, and, keep making great art.
Thanks, man.
God bless you guys.
You too.
Goodbye.
So that's our show today, guys. So excited to have our guest on for King Country. Joel and Luke are amazing storytellers. Love their family. Love the history of storytelling in their family. And I'm really excited for you guys to see this movie, Unsung Hero, out in theaters in April. This one's special, guys. It's really a fantastic film, and they absolutely killed it. So I loved also what they had to say today. And I think what I take away from what they said was just the importance as storytellers of finding stories worth telling. And I like what Joel said of pay attention to where your tears fall, that you have to find something that engages your own soul emotionally, something that you have to communicate, something that moves you. And when you find that emotional experience, being able to communicate it proficiently to an audience. And so that's something that really encourages me, because it's so easy as artists to kind of get into that place where we just start looking at what's marketable, what sells, and we stop thinking about what moves us. And so it's a good word to end on. Guys, just want to thank you guys for being a part of this show. You know, this is something new, and to invite you guys on this journey to be a part of it. We need your voice. We need your vote. We need you to continue to be a part of what we're kind of creating here on The Storytellers. And we're just so excited to make this stories kind of come to life for you guys. So thank you for listening. We'll see you on the next episode of The Storytellers.
The Storytellers is a Kingdom Story Company production. It is produced by Nick Carey, with production assistance from Ben and Justin Bailey. Our executive producers are Kevin Downs and Brandon Gregory. Social media for the show is run by the team at Troops and Allies, and our music is Twisted Rooster by Tommy Prophet. Special thanks to Jaron Weatherly, Evan Johnston, and our entire team at Kingdom Story Company. We have so many exciting guests coming up this season. To ensure you don't miss any of them, subscribe to The Storytellers for free on YouTube at Kingdom Story Company or wherever you listen to podcasts. For exclusive first looks at our upcoming films, behind-the-scenes content, and invitations to advanced screenings, join the conversation as a Kingdom Insider at KingdomStoryCompany.com and follow us at Kingdom Story Company across all platforms. As always, thanks for joining Andrew Irwin and his friends on The Storytellers.